Thank you very much for that introduction. You left out one key part, which is that I have my pen. So if you buy my book, you get this added benefit of me citing it with my own pen, which I was sure to put in my coat this morning. So thank you so much. I'm so thrilled to be here. I was saying earlier that I don't think I've lectured to this many people in quite a while, so I'm really pleased to see such a big turnout. I can't offer you the heavens, as in the previous talk, but I will try to tell you about a little bit about part of our built environment, which interests me very much, which is the Tudor home. And I know some of you are from, even in Nashville, we have quite a few examples, but I'll be showing some others. I was really interested to be invited as part of a series of people who'd written books and talking about their own books. And so I wanted to start with a little bit of autobiography, which I hope you won't object to, which is by way of saying that I think that most books are written because one has a kind of personal passion for the topic, or, the best books, I think, come out of that personal passion, if not obsession. And in my case, my interest in historic architecture and historic houses comes from a deep-seated, what my family would call a borderline, psychotic obsession with houses, especially with old houses, which I think began when I lived in this house, when I was just in elementary school in Scarsdale, New York. Lest you think I come from vast wealth, this was a fixer-upper that my parents bought in about 1965 for $32,000, which I think would go for substantially more than that today. But it really initiated what has really been my lifelong passion, which is for architecture and a real deep-seated interest in talking about what makes great architecture and what makes great domestic architecture. And the book, The Tudor Home, which is here today and I'm going to be focusing on, really comes out of that larger interest in domestic architecture that I've been thinking about so personally and professionally for many, many years. So my own little personal connection to the Tudor, comes from this house, which was one of the first houses that I actually owned. This is the second house I lived in when I taught at the University of Virginia and commuted from Richmond for a while. And, it's super modest, and it will never be shown in an art history lecture ever again. I'm fairly safe in saying. So I refinished that door, I'd like you to know that, in about 1996 or whatever when I owned this house. So it's really typical of a very small-scale Tudor house, the kind that you could find in Nashville in some early 20th century neighborhoods, really in any city that had substantial building at the turn of the century and through till basically to World War II. So it's made of brick, and this part of it, which is kind of lost its half timbering at some point, but you can see it's plaster, this kind of plaster or stucco work. We'll see all of these elements on a much larger scale in grander houses. And it also has a slate roof, which is wonderful. And you also see that in bigger versions in more fancy Tudor houses. But when the publisher, Rizzoli, asked me if I was interested in working on this book, having lived in this little tiny Tudor house, it really appealed to me. And thinking about sort of why the Tudor became such a popular idiom across the United States, I thought would be a really interesting question. One that starts with a paradox, that you could have built in such number, and this is just one example. This is in one of the more suburban neighborhoods of Brooklyn, New York, from around 1899, this house. And I pair it with this, portrait of Henry Tudor, to ask the question, how is it that we think of houses like this, little, you know, suburban houses from the turn of the century, New York City, what in the world do they have to do with this guy? And in a way, it's a real kind of puzzle, but we use the term Tudor all the time, that term that really is associated with the Tudor dynasty in Great Britain, but it's come to be a very common term in talking about houses, as I'm sure you know. So let's go back and look at where it comes from, and I want to look at the historic style that was revived in the late 19th and early 20th centuries in neighborhoods around the U.S. So here we go. Here are a couple of examples from the Weald and Downland Museum in Great Britain, which is an open-air museum that has a number of historic houses from different periods. And here you see what they call the Tudor kitchen here at the top, this building, and then Winkhurst Farm from Tunbridge, Kent, south of London, a rural area, reconstructed at the Weald and Downland Museum in 1969. So these two buildings embody some elements that became very popular for suburban builders at the end of the 19th century, the early 20th century. Among them, this very, what we might call organic feeling, the idea that the house is built out of materials that come from the earth. They're not mass-produced. They don't come from a factory. They're not synthetic. They're not newfangled. They're old-fashioned. They are things like timbers, like wood, and here they're more kind of clay tile slates on the roof, massive amounts of brick, stucco, this kind of half-timbering, which I'll talk more about. All of these elements, very traditional features of British architecture going back really to the 15th century, that became suddenly very popular at the end of the 19th and the early 20th centuries. Here's another example. This is from the 14th century. This is a much larger house, obviously, a kind of manor house, and we'll see how the kind of robber barons of the late 19th century of the U.S. echoed houses like this in their more modern dwellings from the turn of the century. So, for example, we'll see revived this very elaborate patterning that's created by the contrast between timbers and white stucco, called half-timbering, these very small-paned, diamond-paned, leaded glass windows, the whole kind of energetic variety of elements on the facades, these gables of different shapes and sizes, the massive clusters of chimneys, all of these exterior elements will become revived later on. And on the interior, here you see an example from the 14th century, elaborate plaster ceilings, paneling, very heavy paneling, big massive chimneys and so on, leaded glass windows, all of these things revived at the end of the 19th century. I never thought this would get a laugh. I did not put it in there for that purpose. So this is Little Morton Hall, which is a very famous house from the 15th century, again in Cheshire in England. You're laughing, obviously, because it's this kind of riot of this half-timbered effect. So over time, the half-timbering in houses in Great Britain becomes more and more elaborate, and you can see that the builders are very interested in the kind of variety of patterns that can be created through the contrast of the dark stained and light plaster materials. And this is, of course, one of the most exuberant examples, but it really attracts the attention of scholars and architects at the end of the 19th century. Yes, sir.
How was that factor made? Was that drawn?
So it's a mixture of materials, and it changes over time. So it would be a combination, you know, as you quite rightly, straw, you know, other kinds of organic materials in a mixture with a kind of lime, and then with a wash over the top of it to give it that white appearance. So it would have to be repainted over the course of time. So a couple of images here to begin to suggest the revival of these elements at the end of the century. So here, a picture of Bramall Hall from 1883, which was published by Thomas Raffles Davison. And then at the same time, I compare it with this new house. So this was an entirely new house by the British architect Richard Norman Shaw, 1868, Leyswood, which is one of the most famous British houses built at the end of the 19th century, which was very self-consciously reviving the architecture of earlier centuries in Great Britain. Now, why would you do that in 1868? Obviously, you didn't need to have these tiny windows and these steep pitch roofs. You know, there are all kinds of other alternatives in circulation by 1868. So why is it that you would go back to the model these vernacular or kind of builder-designed houses of the earlier age? Well, my suggestion would be that for Norman Shaw and other architects of the 19th century, when they looked back to houses such as this, what they saw was an architecture, first of all, of the pre-industrial age. So they're building in 1868, after the advent of the Industrial Revolution, and particularly in Great Britain, which was very early to industrialize, as you know. So in the wake of all the development of industrial cities in Great Britain and North America, they begin to look back to the pre-industrial period. And that's a phenomenon across the arts. But in architecture, what it generates is a strong interest in this the architecture of the British countryside that used ways of building that were pre-industrial. So there are architects like Norman Shaw looking back to houses that were built before there was mass-produced lumber, before there was mass-produced big sheets of glass that could make windows bigger, before there were all kinds of building technologies that were developed in the 19th century. So they're looking back to this much more traditional architecture because they want to invoke traditional values. They want to invoke, for example, a connection with the land that people worried about in the same way that we do, having been lost as a result of industrialization. You know, that the argument was in the 19th century that the growth of cities had alienated people from the natural world. So a house like this, and this is very much emphasized in this drawing, which was widely published, emphasizes the connection between the building and the landscape. So the house seems to grow right out of the land. The stone outcropping seeming to give rise to the house just right perched above it. Now, the other thing that's important is that there's a kind of idiosyncrasy or very personal aspect to this design. It's not a cookie-cutter house. It's not something churned out by the hundreds or thousands. It's not a kind of contractor house. Instead, it seems very kind of purposefully and personally designed. And again, this comes at a moment when there's a lot of agonizing throughout the West about the impact of mass production and of consumer culture creating a kind of leveling amongst people who then struggle to express a kind of personal identity in their houses. And this is an example. Norman Shaw is also known for this house, Cragside, another very, very well-known house, widely published in the 19th century, also having, you know, some of the characteristic features of Revival architecture of the period, the half timbering, the kind of irregular outline of the house, its connection through its materials to the landscape. And here you see one of the images widely published of the interior with this massive kind of fireplace. Yes, ma'am. Well, it's possible that that salvage wood could be used, you know, from a ship. But first of all, it's pretty hard to get the salvage wood from the bottom of the sea. I mean, I guess the ship could wear out, right? And you'd be on land, and that'd be a little bit more convenient. But then, you know, the need for timber for building exceeded, I think, the what could be salvaged. That said, there was, you know, in the pre-industrial period, a lot of carryover between craftsmen who worked on ships and craftsmen who worked on houses. So, and certainly the skills that were, and the techniques that were used in one area could be used in another. So there's, you know, I think there's certainly a connection whether the actual timbers were reused. That could have happened in some cases, but it doesn't really, wouldn't have supplied all the need. But that's a good point. So, you know, by the 19th century, of course, there's no need for fireplaces to heat your house. There were stoves, which were way more efficient, but there's a kind of insistence on these huge hearths as a symbol, again, of this earlier period that's being harkened back to, the pre-industrial, pre-modern period. Yes, ma'am, you had your hand up. So the wattle and daub would be the material, the kind of straw-based material that's actually in the wall, and then the stucco would be the finish on the outside of it, the smoother kind of more plaster-like finish on the exterior, as I understand it. And that's the surface, the stucco is the surface that would be painted on the exterior. So I show you these two houses in order to leap the pond from your home country, I think, from Great Britain to the U.S. with this wonderful house, which was torn down later. This is from 1884 by a Boston architect in whom I've been interested for a really long time, Robert Swain Peabody, or as we say in New England, Peabody. I've had to train myself not to do that. So this house was called Cragside, and it made deliberate reference to this British house by Norman Shaw, which you just saw a moment ago. And Peabody's argument, which he made in the house, but also in some articles they published at about the same time, was that whereas the British were reviving their historic architecture of the Middle Ages, Americans should be looking back to their historic architecture, which would have been from the 18th and late 17th centuries. And so he called for the revival, particularly of wood shingles, which were not a British, particularly a British building material, but were favored in the U.S. where timber was extremely plentiful, as you know, from in the particularly the 17th and 18th centuries. And so he argued for a corresponding American revival, nonetheless, one that was informed by what had been done in Great Britain. And the great American architect, Henry Hobson Richardson, designed this house, which was similarly an essay on revivals in Britain and their corresponding revival in the U.S., the Watts Sherman House from 1876 in Newport. So if you're going to Newport this summer, I'd encourage you to go see it. It's a dormitory for Salve Regina University, but they don't seem to mind if you go up and press your nose to the door. And of course, you can see the outside, which is just a fabulous house. So Richardson, who was very, you know, trained in, was from the South, trained in France at the École des Beaux-Arts, and then came back and he practiced on Staten Island, now part of New York City, and then in Brookline, Massachusetts, and he died there in 1886. So he designed this house, which is a really wonderful and curious blend of British elements, like the kind of half timbering which you see here, and this is purely decorative in this case. It's not in any way structural. These very small paned windows, the cluster chimneys, massive chimneys that you see here. And like Norman Shaw and the British architects he was interested in, the house grows right out of the landscape. Of course, it's Newport, so it's on the coast. People are there to see the ocean and the waves breaking on the rocks and all that jazz. And so the house really echoes that. And then, interestingly, he uses these wood shingles. So he's blending American and British ideas in the course of this revival. So here we go. Here's the interior. This was designed by the interior by the young architect Stanford White, who had become a partner in the firm of McKim, Mead & White, the huge New York architecture firm, which you have probably heard of. And the interior is important to our story because, first of all, it was widely published, this library. And then it also has this decorative plaster ceiling, which we call as British Tudor and Tudor Revival houses, and the very kind of elaborate paneling. So this is, again, this is 1879, 1881, and this begins to generate a widespread revival of earlier British and American architecture in the work of architects who were from the U.S., but also architects who come here from Great Britain, like this Robert Henderson Robertson, who was a British architect who came to the U.S., and he did this massive house in Lenox, Massachusetts. So we just were looking at Newport, which was a big resort at the end of the 19th century, the early 20th century, as you know. Lenox, Mass. Is the kind of inland Newport in the Berkshire Hills of Western Massachusetts. And you see that this house demonstrates Robertson's familiarity with the Tudor Revival in England. Particularly here you see the kind of half-timbered porte cochere or entrance porch here to the left, and these casement windows and towers and so on are all features that he would have known from British manor houses. And here you see the lawn side, and it has all of those elements that we've seen, or some of them, in earlier British houses, both revival and from earlier centuries, the cluster chimneys, small pane windows, casement windows, half timbering. All of these features would have been readily recognizable to their viewers at the end of the 19th or the beginning of the 20th century as historic features. One author writing in the Crayon Art Magazine in 1891 said, "The now famous town of Lenox, Mass. Ranked 50 years ago with other agricultural towns of New England. The number of visitors there at any one time staying there has gradually risen since then to 2,500 or 3,000. A large proportion of these dwellers in cottages," so what were called, quote unquote, cottages at places like Lenox and Newport, which are, you know, hardly like what we would think of as cottages. They're more like mansions. And this would have, he would have been thinking of something like this. "Whole farms have been sold for country seats." So as the wealthy summer people of Newport, of Lenox, of other communities up and down the East Coast begin to build these massive cottages, they're thinking of the landed gentry of England, and they're modeling themselves on those folks in their choice of architecture. So look at this stair hall at Blantyre. I mean, you know, not, you know, it's very self-consciously Tudor and British. I mean, it's in a way a kind of ridiculous gesture to make in 1900 in Lenox, Mass. I mean, it has nothing to do with anything that had ever existed there before. But it's all has everything to do with making a connection between yourself and this tradition of grand British architecture. Now, the other venue besides resorts where many Tudor houses are built is in the new suburbs of the turn of the century, especially in Westchester County, north of New York City, as well as in the New Jersey suburbs and other suburbs of other big cities as well. But we think of the Tudor as being especially prominent in Westchester, and we talk about the stockbroker Tudor, right? The kind of historic looking house built by the guy who works, and they were always guys at that point, who works on Wall Street and commutes on the train and home to the suburbs in the evening to a house such as this. So this house was designed by an architect who was very active in Bronxville, which was developed along with other nearby communities like Scarsdale and Pelham and other places you might have visited or lived in the New York suburbs, which were serviced by the train, so it was an easy commute. And they had been more kind of agricultural towns in the 19th century, and then those properties were divided up, subdivided for suburban residences by the 1920s. And interestingly, Bowman and there were other architects like him in suburban New Jersey and other suburban Connecticut, other places, who really became specialists in designing suburban houses. So you would buy your lot, and then you go to the local architect and you'd say, I want to build a suburban house. And he might give you a choice of a couple of different styles. And often buyers would focus on this kind of Tudor revival style for the reason that, again, it had associations with a pre-industrial age, what was seen as a more kind of convivial period of domestic harmony, of simplicity, of all kinds of qualities that were seen to be being lost in the 20th century. And it also, of course, had associations with the landed gentry. And so you could claim on your relatively small suburban lot that you too had an essential connection to the land, that you were elite on the basis of your property, your land, and your house. So Bowman then develops a whole variety of interpretations of this Tudor style, often using stone, which and when there's a lot of stone used in this way, the term Cotswold Tudor is sometimes used to refer to the historic architecture of the Cotswolds in Great Britain. And you see he uses again the kind of cluster chimney with lots of indications here at the top that there are lots of flues going down through this chimney, servicing a number of fireplaces. Of course, by the 20s, completely unnecessary, unneeded, just purely decorative, but signaling a kind of traditional domestic life that they want to suggest in the form of the house. Here, using half timbering, this large casement window, and you'll see that there are some details around the door and window openings that are done in historic style, even kind of medieval looking. Here, you see in the gable they use timbers in and then infilling with stone set in this mortar, light-colored mortar. Notice that, you know, heavy timbers used to create pattern on the exterior. Here's another house by Bowman, which I think is pretty wonderful. huge house, which, you know, his own house, and incidentally, he eventually went bankrupt and ended up in a little condo or something in the center of Bronxville. 1921, right? An auspicious moment to be building a gigantic house. So the, you know, stock market crash, of course, is really bad, right, for the stockbrokers who are building these Tudors. For Bowman's business, it's really the kind of the kiss of death, and he has to give up this house, and then eventually, as I said, ends up in much more straitened circumstances. But the house is really wonderful, you know, particularly how it echoes those earlier, the original Tudor houses of Great Britain, with this very dramatic patterning, which by this time, in many cases, is just this kind of surface decoration that's applied to a house that could be built out of concrete and steel beams or, you know, other modern materials. And see how he carries it to the interior. It's really kind of beautiful, the stair hall, despite the zebra rug, which I don't think helps it too much, but echoes the patterning that he carries from the exterior to the interior with these timbers and plaster on the walls and on the ceiling. And here's a little bay window or oriel window hanging in the stair hall, again, bringing the outside in. And you see the stone from the outside carried onto the interior as well. So really emphasizing craftsmanship and traditional organic materials, and built clearly for patrons who have the money to spend a lot on construction. Of course, you know, this is generally out of reach today. Here, the view of the interior, again, with this beamed ceiling, you know, a very traditional kind of motif that's trying to suggest earlier period. And then this recessed hearth, and notice how huge it is, big overscaled hearth, not functional, but decoratively very important. So this is perhaps one pole of suburban building. And then there's this very interesting project of Forest Hills Gardens in Queens, part of New York City, but very suburban in feeling. A whole really self-contained community. I'll go back in a second, but designed by the architect Amar Embery, a lot of the houses. And you can see here on the plan, it's connected to Manhattan by what's now the Long Island Railroad. And this area was all laid out at the same time. This big tract of land became available. And here's the Station Square. So part of the development was a group of commercial and public buildings at the center. And then fanning out from there were houses. Oh, wait, here's, I have a good view of it. Here's the Station Square. It looks almost exactly like that today. So I encourage you, if you go to New York, you must go see it because it's really quite wonderful. An essay or an attempt to do a whole town in a kind of Tudor style using and hiding things like concrete and steel and so on. The construction of this is very up to date, but the detailing of it is very trying to look very traditional. So here's the center of the town, and then around it there are any number of houses, apartment buildings, attached houses, a whole variety of kinds of alternatives for dwelling. And this is, you know, relatively modest back in the day, not anymore, but a kind of mid-level house is part of Forest Hills Gardens with, you know, this kind of tile roof and steeply pitched gables and stucco and all of these forms that were familiar from much larger Tudor Revival houses. Again, relying on the city, close to the city. I've been focusing on New York, but similarly, Philadelphia gave rise to a great number of Tudor Revival and especially Cotswold Tudor houses. And this is one place, and we'll see some other examples, where actual pieces of Tudor houses were brought to the U.S. to be reused. So taking the revival even a step further and actually importing from the U.S. elements of historic houses and incorporating them into new buildings. This happens really quite extensively throughout the East Coast by the 1920s. And in fact, there's a bill introduced in Great Britain that attempts to stop this process because it's seen as this massive drain of historic fabric from Great Britain to the U.S., as rich people buy up dilapidated British houses and sometimes not so dilapidated and move pieces or, big chunks of them to new buildings. So this is a part of an estate built by a very wealthy man named Wharton Sinclair. It has a main house that's owned, I think, now by the University of Pennsylvania. And then around it, he built these smaller houses, which incorporated windows and other materials from historic British houses into a kind of village for the people who worked for him on this estate. Now, they've subsequently been sold off, and now they're quite charming houses. Here's one. Here's the interior of the one I just showed you, the kitchen, and you see these leaded glass windows, which were part of the imported materials. And then here is the view of the living room, which is quite wonderful, with these massive beams, and again, the small paned windows. So this literal importation of elements. And that's also echoed in other forms that are imported, even if the actual materials themselves are imported. And I show you an example from the Chicago suburbs, from Lake Forest, Illinois, which is a North Shore community on Lake Michigan, which you may know or have visited. And this is a house built by the firm of Hart and Shape, for the Smith Peary family. And Peary is important because Carson Peary Scott was a big department store, which some of you may remember from downtown Chicago. So this house was built for a member of the family. And what's so interesting about it is that it echoes the form of thatch, which you see here left on the left-hand side, a thatch cottage in England. This is not thatch. There was not a tradition of, as you know, of thatching roofs in the U.S. So what they did was to echo that form of thatch, that real organic kind of flowing form, and these are actually strips of wood that are then bent. So they're like big wood shingles that are bent into this form to suggest thatch, although to make use of those materials, familiar materials. This is another house by Hart and Shape, and I just show you because it suggests the scale of houses that they're able to do. For Marjorie Merriweather Post, who's a great philanthropist and heiress and extremely wealthy. This is her a house built for her and her husband, E.F. Hutton. I don't need to tell you who he was. On Long Island by Hart and Shape, and obviously clearly in this Tudor mode. Right, Hillstead, yeah. No, this is on Long Island. Yeah. This is the interior of that smaller house by Hart and Shape. I just wanted you to see this stained glass that's used in the doorway there. And another view. One of the great houses of the Tudor Revival that you could go visit is this one, the Eleanor and Edsel Ford House in Grosse Pointe Shores. Grosse Pointe, again, a suburb, wealthy suburb of Detroit, designed by Albert Kahn. This is an interesting story because he's really probably better known as the architect of factories, automobile factories of the early 20th century. And so he would have known the client through that context. Here, 1926 to 29, absolutely massive house, built all of stone in this case. But what's interesting about it is, first of all, the use of these, you know, small paned windows, but on this huge scale, it's quite beautiful. Recessed opening with a stone detailing above it. But making the house, this huge house, look kind of like a village, a manor house that's really on the scale of a British manor house, but he avoids making it seem kind of overbearing by having it sort of ramble across the landscape. And you see when you turn to the interior that the decorations as well as the detailing of the woodwork and so on echo the Tudor feeling of the exterior. It was a project that brought together a number of well-known craftspeople, including the Philadelphia metalsmith Samuel Yellin, who was brought here to do these beautiful gates as well as other metalwork on the inside of the house, where the Fords combined this very British-looking kind of late medieval detailing with a collection of modern art, impressionist and post-impressionist art, as you see here. And here's a detail of the fireplace around. You can just see the attention that's lavished on the woodwork of the house. I want to turn to another example of a community planned in the 1920s, so like Forest Hills Gardens in that sense, but one that incorporated imported houses on a large scale, and that is Windsor Farms, which is located just, it's now part of Richmond on the west end of Richmond, but it was originally an outlying suburb, located right on the James River, which you see here, and laid out by the urban planner named John Nolan, who was very well known in the early 20th century for community plans. And like Forest Hills Gardens, it had a little commercial area here, but mostly the property was divided up into large plots for individual houses. The largest of them, right here on the James River, one of them called Virginia House, which we'll look at first, which is here, and then Agecroft, which is here. And both of them incorporated elements that were brought from directly from Great Britain. And they were the focal point of a community that really saw itself as being steeped in the traditions of Old England. And in Virginia, there was a particular connection because the Virginia elite at that point perceived themselves to be very closely connected to the British gentry. And therefore, it made sense for example, the architect Henry Grant Morse here to design this house, 1925 to 1929, for Alexander Weddle and Virginia Weddle. And it is called, as you see, Virginia House. It's owned by the Virginia Historical Society, and you can go see it. But notice how traditional it is in feeling, and here you see it under construction. And it's a little bit hard to see here, but underlying the historic features that were imported from Great Britain are structural structural elements made out of concrete block, made out of steel, machine-produced lumber, all kinds of modern things were used here, as well as, you know, central heating and other up-to-date systems, but then sheathed in these materials that were imported from a British house. Here you see the interior. This is the library, of course, with this, again, massive hearth. Totally unnecessary, especially in Virginia, I can tell you from experience. And then dining room, and they attempted to purchase furnishings that would complement the medievalism of the house. And here you see through the door this really heavily carved, massive staircase in the front hall. A couple of other details here to show you. The furnishing of the interior, there's a great collection of tapestries. So the trade in tapestries was huge at this point for, and it was specifically for houses such as this, to have that interior be consistent with the exterior. And here on the right-hand side, a small paned leaded glass window with a little motif, a W for the Weddells. And so a lot of these motifs would have been salvaged from British houses and imported. And this provides a view over the extensive gardens which were part of this, not particularly Tudor in feeling, but much more classical. And they were designed by the very well-known Virginia landscape architect, Charles Gillette, who you may have heard of. The gardens much more classical in feeling, but not seeming to disturb the overall aesthetic. So the other big house here was Agecroft Hall, which you see also by Moores. This was done. This was designed for a railroad tycoon in Richmond, and it too, you know, very much based on the use of concrete, steel, other kind of modern materials, but then dressed up with these elements that were purchased from an historic house called Agecroft Hall, which was located outside of Manchester, England, and had been encroached upon by the industrialization there, purchased and then reassembled kind of loosely when it got back to Virginia. One of the important spaces, or one of the great spaces, is the Great Hall at Virginia House, a kind of two-story space, and modeled on the Great Hall that was often a feature of British country houses, which would be a kind of multi-purpose, multi-height space. For example, you see in this painting from the 17th century here on the right. Here, that kind of space echoed in this Great Hall, where it has, you know, massive fireplace, tapestries, small pane windows, all of these things. So very self-consciously imported from Great Britain. A view of the interior, and you see how the collections there echoed the form of the house, the paneling, small pane windows, decorative ceiling, plaster work. And then the owners really went about purchasing furniture that they thought would be consistent with the house, as well as paintings, a portrait there from the 16th century. Another view of the interior. And Agecroft also had these elaborate grounds, gardens that were designed by Gillette as well. Yes, sir?
Are these home residents today?
So these are both museum houses. So you can go visit them. They're historic house museums. But certainly they were conceived of as single-family houses with large servants' quarters. And this is kind of interesting because here you see how the classical garden with its, you know, circular pool then reflects this decorative black and white scheme on the exterior. So I jump here to Pasadena, California, quite a leap geographically, but not so much historically. This is 1906. Pasadena, as you may know, is a lovely community outside of Los Angeles, which developed at the turn of the century as a kind of refuge from the city of Los Angeles, which was becoming larger at this point. And this is an interesting house that I used to connect the Tudor Revival with another movement of the same time, which is sometimes called the Arts and Crafts, the revival of craftsmanship that took place across the arts at the end of the 19th century that had an impact on the production of things for the home, on reviving pottery and metalwork and especially woodwork. And so societies were formed in the major cities that were encouraging craftspeople to turn back to traditional ways of making things. And these brothers, Green and Green, who were from Massachusetts and started out in Boston, and they moved to Los Angeles for health reasons, to be there for the climate, which is what many people did at the turn of the century. And they developed a practice in mostly in single-family houses in Southern California, which interestingly combined this kind of Tudor half timbering with an arts and crafts emphasis on handcraftedness. And really, the interiors that they designed are really masterworks of this arts and crafts style. Here's the entrance hall. You see this, the emphasis that's placed on, all of the elements of the interior, which are beautifully designed and handcrafted. And then, in the little study here, you see again the hearth. Again, I don't have to tell you, Pasadena, you don't need too many wood fires, I don't think. But the emphasis on the brickwork and the heavy beamed ceiling and the furniture that's all designed to go with it, all emphasizing a kind of craftsmanship in a way that had been advocated by William Morris in Great Britain at the middle of the 19th century. Here's the Morris chair, which is one of his great contributions to modern design. A couple more examples here. These are among my favorites. These are four houses that were built in Dallas around 1936 to 1941. So here we're approaching World War II, and we're approaching the moment at which the Tudor becomes kind of old-fashioned, in part because around the time of World War II, more modernist design began to have an impact on house building in the U.S. But holding on until the 1930s and 40s was this Charles Dilbeck, who had a very local practice in Dallas. He did a zillion houses from the 20s, basically through the 40s, and some of them, taking Tudor elements, but I think using them in very creative ways. I think these are very appealing houses, almost kind of abstracting them, I would say. So having, for example, the half timbering, but look, if you just look at this entrance section here, look how he's so interested in the flat patterning here and balancing these two panels against the center door. So the play of light and darks almost becomes, he does it much more broadly than in earlier periods. So I would say, being much more interested in the kind of flat plane of the house in a kind of abstract modernist sort of way. Here's a view of the interior, which of course I think really quite striking and beautiful, with some of the same forms that might have been used, 30 or 40 years earlier, here continuing to be used. Again, a massive, massive hearth with the carving around it. I'm just going through these quickly because I find them to be among the most appealing images in the book. That's one of my favorite houses you see here. So this is where I conclude my story, with the eve of World War I, the rise of fascism in Western Europe that brings a lot of modernist architects to the U.S., where they really transform modern building. And all through this period that we've been looking at, of course, Frank Lloyd Wright has been developing a modernist style for domestic houses. And by the period of World War II, the ranch house will become, I think, the new idiom for suburban building and displace the Tudor revival, which we've seen developing since the end of the 19th century. Nonetheless, I think the Tudor is a really important legacy, and many cities across the U.S., suburbs and resorts. And I hope that as you drive around Nashville, you'll be on the lookout for the wonderful Tudor houses we have right here in our backyards. Thank you very much. Yes. Yes, I believe so. Yes. There is no function. Well, it was the originally it was the structure being visible on the exterior, but you know, by the time it comes to the U.S., it's not at all functional. It's decorative, and what's of interest to people is its decorative character. Yes. Absolutely. The question was, are there versions elsewhere in Northern Europe? Yes, throughout Northern Europe. It's right, they're similar. Each region has its own kind of variation. Here, let me take this. Right, absolutely. Absolutely. There's enormous nationalism in the revival, yes. How big? How many square feet? 15,000 maybe? It's huge. I would guess about that. Yes? A cluster chimney. So a cluster. So it has a cluster of flues that are brought together in one mass. Let me do this individually.